Today, my special guest is Peter Williams, and we're discussing the Greek New Testament produced at Tyndale House, Cambridge. Peter, thanks for joining us on today's show.
Great to be with you.
Well, first off, what are a few things we need to know about your background? Maybe tell us a bit about your education and some of your expertise.
So I'm 47, and I've been studying the Bible and languages to do with the Bible since I was aged 18, so close on 30 years now. Did my degrees through to PhD at Cambridge University in England, and I've been researching and teaching in universities since then.
And for those of us here in the States, if I say Tyndale House, a lot of folks will think of a publisher here in Illinois, but the Tyndale House we're referring to here is a little bit different. So tell us about the work you're doing over there in the UK, and what's the mission and vision that's driving your important work?
Yeah, thank you. So Tyndale House in Cambridge, it's the oldest Tyndale House, in fact, began in 1944. And it was, you know, before even D-Day, the Normandy landings in the Second World War, where some people with real vision wanted to set up a Bible research institute. And it's been doing that for over 70 years now. And it's the leading research institute of the Bible for Bible believers in the entire world. And so we're delighted that we welcome people from around the world to study in our library. And also we sponsor all sorts of research projects. We publish a journal, and we are trying to foster Bible-believing, servant-hearted scholars. We're excited to do that.
Tell us about the origins of this particular Greek New Testament project. How many years has this been in the making, and what was the vision that got it all started?
Well, I think we're told in Matthew 4 that, you know, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God. And that means that as humans, our job is to be obsessed with the question, what does God say? And if we're really obsessed by that question, then we want to have as accurate a copy of that as we possibly can. Now, God spoke his words, and he spoke them in the Bible, in the Old Testament in Hebrew, the New Testament in Greek, and we want to make sure we have access to as accurate a copy of that as we possibly can. So what you do with an edition is you look at all the manuscripts that there are, and you try to bring together from them the most accurate choice of wording that really reflects what was first given. And that's what we've been working on for a decade on, just because it's an act of love for God, an act of trying to serve the church. And we want people to engage with the Bible as much as they can in its original languages. Obviously, I know most of us come to Christ because we're reading it in a modern translation. That's great. I did too. But if the church is really obsessed with the question, what does God say to me, then more of us are actually going to be obsessed by the question about the original languages as well.
And Peter, tell us about your specific role in this project. What sort of things have you been working on?
Well, I mean, I've been taking the institutional lead on making sure we keep to time, and we've had over 30 people involved, but I've been the number two researcher on the project. So we've had a guy called Dirk Jonkent. He's a Dutch guy who actually used to be in charge of the earliest complete manuscript of the New Testament, Codex Sinaiticus, in the British Library. And he's been working, leading on that. And I've just been his research assistant, which has been really great fun, looking at manuscripts morning, noon, and night.
For those of the folks listening who have a background in studying Greek, most of us are familiar and probably have in our library either a Nestle Aland or a UBS text. How specifically does this new edition differ from those texts that we're familiar with? What are some of the additional benefits we're going to realize there?
Well, I want to start with what's the same, because one of the great things we find is that we're working independently from the people who made the Nestle Aland edition or the United Bible Society's edition, and we're coming to pretty similar results. So the first 14 verses of John's Gospel, 182 words, 812 letters, we're actually identical. And in fact, we're also identical to what Erasmus did in 1516. I mean, there just isn't a letter difference. And that's pretty amazing, because Erasmus didn't have manuscripts earlier than the 12th century, and we've got manuscripts going back to the 3rd century for that. So that's one encouragement. But then there are these little differences which we're finding and we're excited about. So with our edition, every single paragraph is not a modern editorial decision like they tend to be. We've actually taken them from ancient manuscripts. And one of the things we found, for instance, is you take the parable of the sower in Mark chapter 4, verse 3, and we're putting the paragraph mark not before Jesus' first word, but after his first word. So literally what Jesus says is, he says, listen, And then he says, behold, the sower went out to sow. So we've got that paragraph mark after the listen and before the behold. And we've done that because four of the five earliest manuscripts do it. That tells us quite a few things. One is that the way we should read it is Jesus says, listen up, guys. And then you have to pause and then you let your mind's imagination visualize the sower going out to sow. And then, of course, the whole thing ends with whoever has ears to hear, let him hear. That's a nice way of putting it. And it's quite striking that the early manuscripts we have, which we find in different cities, they've emerged in different places, they actually all have the same paragraph mark, or four of the five do. That's amazing because it shows that the early scribes are caring about these little details. It's not that we can be sure that comes from Mark himself, but we can be sure that early hearers of the Gospels, early copyists of the Gospels saw that as being the breakpoint. So that's just a small example. I can give many more.
I'd be curious if you'd be able to expand a little bit more about the study of scribal habits. That seems to be something that's really come into its own in the last several years. Why is it important as we're studying to try to get inside of their heads, if you will?
Well, I think it's really fascinating now that we're able, we've got enough manuscripts to try and get quite specific about what an individual scribe might do. Some of them are very careful about copying spelling. Some of them aren't. Some of them omit words. Some of them are more careful. And really get to know the characters of the different writers of manuscripts before you start trying to use them as witnesses to the New Testament. Because if you don't, the danger is you are just picking a manuscript because it's early or it's convenient and saying, well, this is what we should put in the Bible. And I think you need to be a lot more careful about that. And so we're trying to, if you like, filter all of that information that comes, get to know as far as we can these people who wrote a long time ago, get to know the sort of mistakes they made. And that helps us not sit in our armchairs and decide what's earlier, but actually to work out using the brains that God's given us what's likely to be earlier and what's likely to be later.
And tell us about the concise textual apparatus that's paired with the text for people that study and are going to use that sort of a thing. What are some of the things that make it stand out?
So the apparatus at the bottom of the page doesn't take up a lot of the page because we want people to read the text. I would love to have a million people read the Greek New Testament through, the entire thing. I don't think that's an unreasonable desire. And so one of the things about our apparatus is we don't want it to be obscure, full of Latin abbreviations and lots of signs you need to learn. We want actually this to be available for ordinary people to read. So we've made it so that when you're reading the main text, you don't have any distractions that stop you reading. We don't allow lots of editorial signs in there. But if you look down to the bottom of the page, the really important variations there are, we're going to signal in the manuscripts, and we're going to signal them in quite a simple way.
And you already touched on this a little bit earlier, but I wanted to go back to it. I mean, we're at a time where we've got numerous English translations available. But why is it critical for us to continue pursuing Bible study in the original languages? Because we've seen kind of an ebb and flow where this is, as an area of focus, it's definitely gone down at a lot of seminaries and Bible schools. So talk to us about why we really need to keep pursuing that as a foundation of our studies.
Well, I think it's really interesting that we, at least in the West, have never had greater access to God's Word or information about God's Word. And just on your cell phone, you can get all sorts of information about the Bible and all sorts of apps that will help you on that. So it's never been easier. But the other side is that we've never been quite so distracted. You know, we've got so much entertainment that we're actually forgetting what God said. Now, what's our job in life? Our job in life is not to be successful. Our job is to listen to what God says and heed it and to be faithful to that. God may give us success in all sorts of areas, but that's not our actual job. So our job is to say, Master, speak, we're listening. And so that does mean that actually listening to what God says is even more important than praying. And that may shock people, but surely we've got to give what God says to us priority over what we say to God, even though prayer is incredibly important. So that does mean that just as today we're quite obsessed about what we eat and we have therefore all the lists of ingredients on all sorts of packets, and parents see it as their job to read the packets to know what ingredients they're giving their kids, even though most parents don't think they're dietary specialists, right? So similarly, I think ordinary Christians don't need to think of themselves as Greek scholars, but they do want to take an interest in the precise details of what God says. Just as we take interest in the precise number of calories in something we eat, we want to know that sort of stuff. So I think it's part of being a part of loving God is really wanting to know in really precise terms, what exactly is he telling me?
And why should this Greek New Testament be on the desk of every scholar and every pastor?
Well, I'm not saying every pastor in the world, because, you know, there are all sorts of pastors with not many resources at all. But I do think that what's a pastor's job? Well, a pastor is a shepherd, and there are a few jobs for a shepherd. A shepherd is to protect the flock, but a key thing that the shepherd does is they feed the flock. And so that means that just as, say, with a parent, they are checking the ingredients before they feed their kids. A responsible parent doesn't just give their kids junk food. A responsible pastor doesn't give their congregation junk food. They actually are trying to make sure that what gets through nutritionally, spiritually, for their flock is as good as it can be. And so I think that just means that, of course, the shepherd has to do due diligence on the nutrition content of what they pass on. They need to be able to check those sort of things. And they're not doing their job if they're not doing that. Does that make sense?
Yeah, that makes total sense. Thank you. Tell us about some of the different editions that are available. Crossway's got a couple editions. It's available online. You're also working with Cambridge as well. And if I remember correctly, there's also going to be an audio edition in partnership with Bible Mesh. So tell us kind of the vision for publication.
We're just beginning out on this. And we've only got one edition, but it's got five different bindings. So it's the same wording inside and the same page layout. But there are a few, there are three different linings or covers with Cambridge University Press, two of them quite high-end leather ones. And there's also with Crossway, there are a couple of different ones. And so there's a range of beautiful products. We really want this to be beautiful, you know, for the glory of God. And then we've got our friends at Bible Mesh who've got some folk from a monastery in Greece to be reading this out loud. So you can get the audio of that as well. The text is free there online. It's going to be available in a lot of the major Bible software as well as on apps. So we're trying to push forward on that, and we're going to try and produce more and more bindings, more and more different looks, so people can avail themselves of that.
Yeah, it is nice that it's available in a range of options and prices. I had a chance to look at the hardcover edition from Crossway, and that actually comes with a very nice slipcase that is in, so it'll look nice on your shelf. And Crossway also has a True Tone edition that's available here in the States as well. Peter, if the listeners want to find out more about the work of Tyndale House, if they want to find out more about this Greek New Testament, where are a couple of the places they can go on the web to do that?
Well, to find out about Tyndale House, just go simply to tyndalehouse.com. Tyndalehouse.com, that's our website, and that will tell you about what we do. And then for the Greek New Testament, they just go to thegreeknewtestament.com. So tyndalehouse.com and thegreeknewtestament.com, they will tell you what you need to know.
Once again, our book today was The Greek New Testament, produced at Tyndale House, Cambridge. You can find out more at thegreeknewtestament.com and also at tyndalehouse.com. Peter, I just want to say thanks so much for sharing with us today. It has been a great pleasure speaking with you.
Thank you.